So then I wrote a paper on how one might leverage the Aegis air defense system, the Navy Aegis system, to do missile defense, theater missile defense. In other words, fleet defense, or maybe theater missile defense in a particular AOR, area of responsibility, a theater, not strategic.
Right.
And gave it to a congressman that I was doing a bunch of work with, who then gave it to the vice chairman of the House Armed Services Committee, Kurt Weldon, who then called Congressman Rohrbach up and said, what is this guy from, like, Lockheed or Boeing? No, he's a guitar player for the Doobie Brothers, you know, a studio musician, you know.
Welcome to Second Act Stories, a podcast that profiles people who have made major life and career changes and are pursuing more rewarding lives in a second act. I'm your host today, Scott Merritt.
And I'm Andy Levine, Scott's co-host for Second Act Stories. Scott, you interviewed a fascinating person today, amazing backstory and also an amazing second act story. Tell us about Jeff Skunk Baxter.
Where do I even begin? So he's a Rock and Roll Hall of Fame musician. He was inducted in 2020. He was the founding lead guitarist of Steely Dan. He was a member of the Doobie Brothers. I mean, he has played with a veritable who's who of rock and roll and other musicians. He was even the inspiration for the Muppet guitarist Floyd Pepper after he did some session work for Jim Henson at Sesame Street. So Skunk has a brand new album out. It was just released. It's called Speed of Heat. It's his first solo album, and it's really, really, really good.
All right. His musical background is fascinating, but so is his second act. Tell us about that.
Yeah. So Skunk is actually, this is where it gets interesting. He's a missile defense and counterterrorism consultant, and he consults at the highest levels. I'm talking about the Pentagon, the White House, the Joint Chiefs. Because of that, he did ask us to play this quick disclaimer at the top of the interview.
And I also, maybe you can put this in the beginning too, that what I'm speaking about here, I am not representing in this conversation any branch or any part of the U.S. government. All these opinions and all these ideas are my own. And I am not here in any shape or form to represent the U.S. government.
We start by talking about his passions, which, as you can imagine, were focused on music.
My mother was kind enough to, when I asked her for piano lessons at age 5, she got me a piano teacher. And she did two very special things for me. One was getting me a piano teacher, and number two was teaching me to read. My other passion was mechanics, stuff, taking things apart and putting them back together and trying to figure out how they worked.
What did you want to be when you were a kid? What did you want to do when you grew up?
I wasn't really sure. I loved music and I thought being a DJ would be fun. I didn't really realize until I was around 10 or 11 that I enjoyed playing, especially the guitar, in bands. We formed a surf band when we were 11 years old and began to realize that that's something that I really, really wanted to do, is play.
At what point did it become the dominant force?
Well, I'm not sure in a formal sense that I sat down, made a list, put being a successful musician at the top of the list, because there were so many other things that I was doing. My father was very interested and very focused on me getting a good education. So he enrolled me in Green Gates Academy, it was called. Mm-hmm. And I began to get a formal British underclass education. And then my dad sent me to prep school in the United States for 4 years. The last year, my senior year in prep school, I was a nominal member of what was known as the problem children. Right. So we were under the auspices of the dean of students there, Mr. Oscarson, Donald Oscarson. And the band that I was in had played so many school dances that other prep schools, especially women's prep schools, were asking if we could play at their dances. So Mr. Oscarson, in his infinite wisdom, became our de facto manager, started booking us at St. Margaret's and Dobbs Ferry and Emma Willard and Ethel Walker and all these different girls' schools, and was taking 5%, which was perfect as far as I was concerned.
So you cut your teeth on the prep school circuit in the Northeast?
Absolutely. The whole prep school idea, the whole concept of boarding school, at least as far as I could tell, was not so much what you learn, it's how you gain and leverage the tools to learn. It made me realize something, that the teachers that I had and the professors that I had and the guidance that I had, these people were not conventional. They didn't think conventionally. And they saw the world through a multi-faceted lens, where what was normal may or may not be what is important.
Right. So how did that prepare you for, you know, what was to come, which, you know, you had no idea what ultimately was going to happen at that point. But how do you feel like that atmosphere, that kind of upbringing got you ready for success?
I believe that much of my ability, and I guess would be openness to accepting challenges, came from a string of experiences that I had with some very special people.
So you go through this, sounds like, really awesome experience with prep school, and you wind up at Boston University?
Yes, for a year. I took a leave of absence. I went to the School of Public Communications. And James Montgomery was one of my roommates from the James Montgomery Blues Band. We became close friends, and we would play together downstairs in the cafeteria whenever we had some time. So there was music everywhere, all the time.
Well, it sounds like it, and that seems appropriate for the situation.
And I was repairing and customizing guitars in my room at the college dorm. So I was meeting a number of musicians at the same time.
How did you get into, well, okay, so you said that you were really into taking things apart, putting them back together, and that sort of fed that, and then you're playing music and you have a passion for music, so it all seems to fit together.
I mean, my dad was kind enough to give me a copy of the U.S. Army Communications Corps radio manual, which had a very basic analog to a passive equalization circuit, which I believe actually Leo Fender used in his first amplifiers. But so again, you stick a knife in a toaster and very quickly you find out which direction the electrons flow, and you kind of take it from there. And then when I went to boarding school, so you go to New York and work in the music stores on 48th Street. But when I was working on 48th Street at Jimmy's Music Shop, Dan Armstrong, who had a very sophisticated and probably the only real guitar customizing shop on the East Coast at the time, saw that there weren't any guitars coming out of Jimmy's music shop for repair. So he came down and said, "How much you make now?" I said, $1.25 an hour. That was in 1964. It was minimum wage. And he said, "I'll pay you $5 an hour." And I, of course, are you kidding me?
Right.
So I went to work for Dan and learned a tremendous amount about the guitar, its mechanics, the electronics that were involved, as well as meeting some of the most incredible guitar players I've ever met in my life.
All right. So while you're in New York, you somehow come across Jimi Hendrix. How does that all happen?
It was a kind of a chance thing. I was working at Jimmy's music shop, and a gentleman came in. He said his name was Jimi James, and he came in with a beat up Fender Duosonic guitar and was looking to upgrade. And I had just finished customizing a right-handed Stratocaster for a left-handed player, or I had done it about a month ago, and the person never came back for it. So it was there in the case. So I grabbed it and said, I'll trade you even. And so when Jimmy and Frank, who were the owners of Jimmy's music shop, found out about it, they docked me 3 weeks' pay, which was fair enough because the guitar was obviously worth much more than the trade-in. And then he came in to get a set of strings and invited me to come down and see him play at the Café Wa. And that was it. The bass player was a little late, so I sat in for a couple of tunes. And we became, I can't say close friends, but the time that we did spend together was really good. He was a very good man.
So let me back up a moment, though. When you had that customized restrung Strat and you traded him for what he had brought in, was that the first Strat that he had that was strung backwards?
It may have been. It may have been. It was a white Strat. I remember that. I strung it. I had to re-intonate it. I had to recut the nut. There was a lot of work that went into it.
Yeah.
Actually.
Yeah. I believe
that could very well be true.
That's incredible. I mean, that's just, you know, Jimi Hendrix was absolutely known for his, you know, backward strung Stratocaster, and you very well may have been the first person to introduce him to that.
I could be. I had seen him play other instruments. I'd seen him play a jazz master. I saw him play a Dan Electro. And of course the Duosonic that he brought in was strung, you know, left-handed. It was right-handed sure. instrument. So that very well could have been. He certainly liked the guitar.
Incredible. Wow. So you're in New York at that point. What brings you out to LA, and when did that happen?
I left Boston University after a year and started working in music stores in Boston and repairing guitars and playing in bands and doing a lot of studio work and commuting back and forth to New York. I met Gary Katz, who ended up being the producer for Steely Dan. He talked to me and he said, I have an artist in New York that I'm producing, and I have these two songwriters, Walter Becker and Donald Fagen, who are writing for her album for Linda Hoover. Mm-hmm. And would you come down to New York and work on the project? And I said, sure. So I got on the train, headed down, worked on the project. And then afterwards, I said, you know, I've never really heard music like this. This is really cool. And both Walter and Donald said, well, we've never heard anybody play guitar like you, so maybe we should think about, and I use the phrase, whoever goes past go first makes the call. And Walter Becker and Donald Fagen managed to get a publishing deal with ABC Records in Los Angeles.
Skunk played on Steely Dan's first three albums, on hits like Dirty Work, Reelin' in the Years, My Old School, and Ricky Don't Lose That Number, which features one of his most legendary guitar solos.
So when you started playing with them, you said that they were doing something a little bit different. There was this different vibe to what Donald Fagen and Walter Becker are doing. Did you have a sense that it was something special?
Well, I have to be careful when you say special. It was different, and I liked it. And there was no doubt that I had not heard anyone else do anything in the musical genre quite like that.
So I'm going to fast forward a little bit, even though I could probably talk about Steely Dan for the next 2 hours. So Steely Dan stops touring, right? So the guys decide that they're just going to record with session musicians and record music and not tour. That led to your departure from the band. And you immediately shifted over to the Doobie Brothers, or seemingly immediately. Was it immediate? Was it a pre-calculated move on your part?
I believe it was less than, it was between 7 and 10 seconds. I was already playing in their band, but I was at the Nebworth Festival with the Doobie Brothers, and I had just gotten off the phone. And I can't remember if it was Denny Diaz or if it was Walter Becker. And yeah, so basically saying, you know, we're just not interested in touring anymore. And I thought, well, I am. I like to tour. So I hung up the phone and said, well, I think that's it for me and Steely Dan. And one of the members of the Doobies said, well, now you're in the Doobie Brothers.
Wow.
Okay.
So
that works.
Skunk recorded 5 albums with the Doobie Brothers, playing on some of the band's biggest hits and contributing to what would eventually get them all inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Skunk was also responsible for ushering in an entirely new era for the Doobie Brothers.
Not only did you join the Doobie Brothers, but you also were responsible for bringing Michael McDonald, which led to a whole different era and a different sound for the Doobie Brothers, but it was just as important to their history. How did that move happen?
Tom Johnson, one of the founding members of the Doobies and responsible for much of their success, was having some severe health problems. So I picked up the phone, and after a very brief conversation with the manager of the Doobie Brothers, Bruce Cohen, I called Michael and said, I'm sending you a one-way ticket. You're going to join the Doobie Brothers. I think you should do this. And he said, oh, okay. Came out. We rehearsed for 8 days straight, 8 to 10 hours a day. Went out 10 days later. We got 5 encores. And I guess I made the right decision.
Wow. Well, I would say, again, history proves that that decision was a really good one. You've spent 5 fruitful years with the Doobies, and then you departed. What led to that departure?
If you're a change agent, you have to recognize change. And I certainly, as you said, was responsible on some visceral level for making a somewhat major change in the direction of the band. Adding a keyboard player makes a big difference on a lot of levels.
Right.
Musically, Michael was really reaching his, really coming into his own as an artist. And much of the band direction was focused on that. And there was not a whole lot of room for a style of guitar playing that was kind of open-ended, that eclectic. So it just, it was the right time.
So it was time to change, period.
So absolutely.
So you,
plus I was starting to produce records. I had more studio work than I knew what to do with.
Right. So my next question was actually going to be about being a session player, right? You've played with, music royalty, Eric Clapton, Dolly Parton, Barbara Streisand, Ringo Starr. I mean, the list goes on and on and on and on. When you're that in demand and when there's that much work, how do you select the gigs you do and the gigs you wouldn't do? Because you're only one person.
You take them all. And you take them all, because the one thing that is a reality is there are 2,000 people waiting for that chair.
You have this unique style that adds to your mystique. You often play seated. How did that become part of the way you play, a part of your persona?
Well, for a little while, I had a knee problem. But way before that, I was a sit-down player, because in the studio, you always sit down. When you first buy a guitar, you sit down. And yes, for performance purposes, there were times when I would stand up and play. But when I joined the Doobie Brothers, there was so much going on in the band. I thought maybe my place was to sit on a comfortable drafting stool with headphones on, recreate the studio experience for me, no matter whether there were 500,000 people or 3 people.
Yeah.
And that's what I do.
I easily could have spoken to Skunk Baxter about Steely Dan, the Doobie Brothers, and all his session work for hours. But we had a job to do, and that job was to talk about his second act career. So that's where we headed next. In the mid-80s, Skunk realized he had a passion for the defense industry. I asked him how that came about.
Well, much of the literature that I was reading at the time was defense related. I had met a gentleman named Robert Bob Wendt, who was one of the pioneers in aerospace, Sidewinder missile. And he gave me as a gift the subscription to Aviation Week and Space Technology. And I had already been reading the defense magazines and defense publications before that, while I was still in Doobies, because working with Roland, especially Roland, I've been with them for 47 years now, and Fender and Akai and other electronics companies, the digital revolution, so to speak, really began with the military. In ARPA, the whole concept of utilizing the new digital technologies for all kinds of things, communication, data storage, what was going to be future radar, how this would leverage and help in terms of space exploration, et cetera, et cetera.
So how does that interest, though, give way to a consulting career?
I had an idea that, based on a paper that was given to me by the senior aviation editor of James Defense Weekly, Nick Cook, he showed me a paper that posited that, based on some very real mathematics, that you could track the space shuttle on orbit with an S-band radar. The Navy at the time, and still on their Aegis air defense system, uses the S-band for their radar, the S-band frequency spectrum. So when he said you could track the space shuttle with an S-band radar, I started to think, And I had read some articles about missile defense just sort of starting out. I read the history of the Spartan program, Sprint, and that whole beginning missile defense, early missile defense. And I don't know, something clicked in my head. So I went to a buddy of mine who was a steel player and also at JPL and said, John, can you do some math for me? I said, sure. So I gave him some stuff that I needed done, and he came back to me and said, what are you doing? I said, I got this idea. He says, are you trying to track something with a radar cross section of about 2 feet? I said, yeah. I said, well, it's doable. So then I wrote a paper on how one might leverage the Aegis air defense system, the Navy Aegis system, to do missile defense, theater missile defense. In other words, fleet defense, or maybe theater missile defense in a particular AOR, area of responsibility, theater, not strategic.
Right.
And gave it to a congressman that I was doing a bunch of work with, who then gave it to the vice chairman of the House Armed Services Committee, Kurt Weldon, who then called Congressman Rohrbach up and said, what is this guy from, like, Lockheed or Boeing? No, he's a guitar player for the Doobie Brothers, you know, a studio musician, you know.
Yeah.
So I got a call from Kurt Weldon. We just classified your paper, by the way. So you need to get your clearances now. And would you take a position on the Armed Services Committee to head up what we're going to call the Civilian Advisory Board on Missile Defense? And then the next thing I knew, I was working at the Pentagon and I was out at Lawrence Livermore. Working on high energy, you know, diode pump solid state lasers.
You know, how do you translate from, you know, the world of music and recording technology? Like, where is that link?
Well, as I've told a number of my friends in the military and in government, a radar is just an electric guitar on steroids. Once you understand the physics of frequency, have a fairly decent handle on physics in general and theoretical physics and electromagnetism and electronics, it all makes perfect sense. I mean, one of the guys I worked with at Lawrence Livermore, Charlie Towns, he won the Nobel Prize for co-inventing the laser and invented the maser as well. And he talked about coherent oscillations. Well, a laser is just one frequency of light, one frequency all in phase. Well, that's kind of what happens when you strike a guitar string. It vibrates at 440 times a second, right? What happens if you double it to the second to the first harmonic? It's 880 times a second, right?
Mm-hmm.
It oscillates. Right. What time you double that? What do you get? 1620 times a second. What happens if you multiply it times 10 to the 23rd power? You get the color green. Green, the frequency of the color green is a super harmonic of A440. And once you understand how all that's connected, everything else just falls into place.
The big question is, how do you leap from being really interested or really well versed on military defense to becoming an expert that they're calling on?
The paper that I wrote was accepted by a number of people. And certainly there was some research on it beforehand. But first of all, I figured, okay, in light of your question, what the hell? You know, whiskey tango foxtrot here.
Mm-hmm.
And then people were interested in saying, okay, well, if you know something about that, you have an opinion on this.
So what is it that you think that you brought to the conversation that didn't exist before and that caused people to listen to you?
I wasn't brought up in the military mental framework. So I don't really see that anything is impossible. I think the Marines have a great saying that the difficult we do immediately, the impossible just takes a little longer. I am a believer in that tenet, that everything is possible. And because I'm an improvisational musician, because I look at things from a very improvisational and I believe creative point of view, creativity is based on having as few boundaries as possible. But I believe that when they would present me with a problem, I was not bound by any rigor or prejudice.
Can you talk about any projects that we may have heard of where your ideas led to some kind of success? Something that's not classified?
The one thing that I do a lot of is wargaming. I'm sort of a professional red team guy. I am a bad guy. My job is to be the worst nightmare as an opponent, as a strategic near peer or peer opponent to the United States. And so being creative, first immersing myself in the culture and the military and the culture of the adversary, and then translating that into doctrine, strategy, and even on a tactical level. That's something I do a lot of. I've been complimented a number of times on being, they call me Dr. Doom.
Part of your job, though, with this wargaming aspect of what you're doing is to kind of think three steps ahead the way a terrorist would think, and to make sure that we're prepared for that kind of a possible scenario.
Oh, yeah. And have been both lauded and punished for being creative.
So how does an incredibly successful Hall of Fame career in music prepare you for consulting with the Pentagon on missile defense and counterterrorism?
Well, I think we touched on a little bit before. Terrorists are very creative. If you are trying to defeat an adversary that is extremely militarily powerful, economically powerful, socially and structurally powerful, you have to think of different ways to do things. You can't afford to buy a guided missile. You can't afford to buy a sophisticated guidance system. You can't afford the money, blood, and treasure and research it takes to develop a powerful warhead. So what do? You use an airplane as a missile. You use fuel as the explosive. And you substitute a guidance system with a human being. Makes perfect sense. So the terrorists have done a number of things. Certainly, IEDs, improvised explosive devices, triggered by a cell phone, triggered by a garage door opener. I mean, the list goes on and on and on of novel, inventive, and creative ways for someone to attack, affect, attack, and possibly defeat a much more powerful adversary.
So here you are with decades worth of a musical background, and you're bringing that level of creativity to just solving a different problem.
I hope so. I think the muscle is the same. And I think that once you are comfortable in the creative arena, you can easily adapt. It's taking a way of thinking and reapplying it. It's taking a template that you already have,
right,
and applying that template. Again, it's like Lieutenant Colonel John Boyd, the OODA loop. You observe the problem. You orient yourself in the problem. You decide what you're going to do about the problem, and then you act. Now, whether it's cleaning dog poop from a rug or figuring out exactly how you're going to defeat a superior force in the Ukraine, it's the same template. It's just having a template that is expandable enough, an architecture, if you will, that is open-ended enough to accept pretty much anything.
So interesting. What advice would you give to someone who has a passion but doesn't know how to pursue it in a meaningful way?
What I would do is the internet is a fabulous tool. If you have a passion for something, try to find somebody else that does. or try to find somebody who's tangential to that. In other words, if you're working in a job, say you're working at Fender and you're building guitars, but you have a passion for health, finding someone, a colleague who has a relative or something who is having health problems and a particular area, and maybe you can talk to that person and find out who their physician is. And maybe you have an idea about how that, maybe it's musical therapy. Maybe it's the ability to find the resonant frequency of a tumor and kill it. There's a lot of work being done in that now, and that stems directly from music. Finding people that are interested in what you're interested in. There are a lot of groups that come together online to do that, and then communicate with them. And don't be shy. Don't, you know, you may be working in a business where they say, you're being paid to only think this. And most of the time, it's difficult to find someone who you can talk to because everybody's afraid of losing their job. But every once in a while, you know, in the cafeteria or at a, you know, a somewhere in a meeting or something like that, you find somebody who says something, go up to them. Don't be shy.
After this engrossing conversation with Jeff Skunk Baxter, I realized that he's operating on an entirely different level than I am. And that's just fine. The world needs people whose passions lie in developing creative new ways to protect our country. The fact that some of them happen to be Rock and Roll Hall of Fame musicians, whose music has left an indelible sonic mark on our lives, just makes it that much more interesting. Here are two thoughts that occurred to me after our conversation. First, you can't schedule inspiration. Passion is innate, and it'll surface when and how it needs to. You just have to allow yourself the freedom to pursue it. Second, it's never too late for a second act. Skunk Baxter was well established in his music career long before he got serious about missile defense, and eventually consulting with the government. And a third bonus thought, did we just discover that Skunk Baxter was the one who built Jimi Hendrix's first white Stratocaster? That's never been shared anywhere else. It's mind-blowing. Anyway, Andy and I are always on the lookout for new people to profile on Second Act Stories. If you'd like to suggest a candidate, we'd love to hear from you. Visit our website at www.secondactstories.org and click on the Nominate a Guest box at the top of the homepage. We hope you'll keep listening. There are more Second Act Stories just around the corner.